and join together in singing Alleluia, Love is Alive, which is found on the yellow music sheets.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of God's kingdom. Lord, have mercy. You come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy. You will come in salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. May your people exult forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
This morning's readings are in the Gather Book 9:5-5. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and proclaimed, "You who are Jews, indeed all of you staying in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to my words. You who are Israelites, hear these words. Jesus the Nazarene was a man commended to you by God with mighty deeds, wonders, and signs, which God worked through him in your midst, as yourselves know. This man delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God, you killed using lawless men to crucify him. But God raised him up, releasing him from his throes of death, because it was impossible for him to be held by it. For David says of him, I saw the Lord even before me. With him at my right hand, I shall not be disturbed. Therefore, my heart has been glad and my tongue has exalted. My flesh too will dwell in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to the netherworld, nor will you suffer your holy ones to see corruption. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with your joy in your presence. My brothers, who can confidently say to you about the patriarch David that he died and was buried, and his tomb is in our midst to this day? But since he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants upon his throne, he foresaw and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that neither was he abandoned to the netherworld, nor did his flesh see corruption. God raised this Jesus. Of this we are all witnesses. Exalted at the right hand of God, we receive the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father and pour forth his forth as you see and hear. The word of the Lord.
From of old, you are my heritage, you my
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, if you invoke as Father him who judges impartially according to each one's works, conduct yourself with reverence during the times of your sojourning, realizing that you were ransomed from your futile conduct, handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of spotless, unblemished lamb. He was known before the foundation of the world, but revealed in the final time for you, who through him believed in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus, and they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped, looking downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he replied to them, "What sort of things?" They said to him, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. How our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And besides all this, it is now the third day since this took place. Some women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described, but him they did not see. And he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets spoke. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?" So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread, the gospel of the Lord.
That's kind of like how the resurrection appearances were. He leaves and he comes back. When I was 10 years old and a few weeks before fifth grade, grade five, in the living room, my mother held a press conference in the living room to announce to my brothers and me that we were going to a new elementary school, to leave the public school in our neighborhood and go to the Catholic school across town. As a future Catholic priest, you would think I would have been glad at this news, but I was not. Change was bad. At age 10, in a relatively short span of time, I experienced a range of emotions from fear, anger, disgust, sadness. If I had known about the official stages of grief, I would not have been interested because I could not bargain my way out of this. I bring this up because there is a great change happening to the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. They also do not like change. Their world has been turned upside down by the death of Jesus, of whom they expected great things. He was mighty in word and deed. Now, due to the mysterious plan of God, which they do not comprehend, Jesus had been put to death, and they are experiencing a range of emotions, fear, anger, sadness. When Jesus himself appears as a random bystander to them and asks, "What were you talking about as you walked along?" they respond, "Distress. Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know what happened?" This is an ironic question because Jesus is the only visitor to Jerusalem who knows what really happened. Don't you know? Don't you get it? Isn't this how we express ourselves in times of complaint or frustration, or when we feel misunderstood or misdirected? For example, to one's wife or husband, one might say, "Don't you know? Don't you get it?" We might say this to our children, or to our adult children, to our friends, to our siblings, to coworkers, neighbors, a boss. "Don't you know? Don't you get it?" Perhaps you were trespassed against or wronged, or you feel you were. At times, in true justice, rather than simply saying, "Don't you know?" sometimes we are called to inform people about what we want them to know. In a loving way, we do have a right to our private thoughts, to our private judgments. But we are called to pray over those things, to pray over them and through them, to bring them to our Lord, who wants us to enter into our pain, into our fear, into our anger, into our sadness. And he did so by taking up his cross and dying for you and me. Jesus is your personal Savior who wants you to talk to him, to pray to him. He is not a mind reader or a fortune teller. In the meanwhile, don't we have all our competing emotions and feelings to deal with? In 2015, there was a popular movie by Pixar Studios, which also made Toy Story, a popular movie by Pixar called Inside Out. I highly recommend this movie. It was totally fictional, but Inside Out has been very positively reviewed by psychologists, by religious scholars, Christians, Catholics, as an accurate and family-friendly view of our emotions and their meaning. The movie reminded me of my own 10-year-old self because the main character, named Riley, is a 10-year-old who is told by her parents that the family has to move for professional reasons from the Midwest in Minnesota to the West Coast in California. The movie is not just about people as characters, but each emotion is a different character on the screen. So joy or gladness is a yellow sunshine character. Sadness is blue. And joy or gladness is used to being the emotion in charge of all the other emotions, but now has to fight off or deal with all the other emotions of fear, anger, sadness. And every emotion in our lives, every feeling in our lives has a place. There's no such thing as a life without feelings of sadness or anger or fear. Yet these emotions can get us into trouble. They have gotten me into trouble. They have been near occasions of sin. We can at times in fear and sadness lose ourselves to love in all the wrong places, or to feelings of being devalued or diminished. Or we may pursue pleasures or entertainment or even information which are wrong. Pleasure, entertainment, information are not bad. They're good. But sometimes, for example, gossip is a form of information, isn't it? In prayer and repentance, we are called not to ask God to eliminate these emotions, but rather to heal our injuries and brokenness and bring to the Lord what is troubling us. This was expressed by the two troubled travelers on the road. They did not fully recognize Jesus, but still were able to say, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over." My experience of changing schools was, in fact, a positive experience in which I made many new friends. I am grateful, but it was not what I was looking for at that moment. I am also aware of my inclination to find only what I am looking for, to my own attitude of over-evaluation, or as we say, analysis paralysis, the paralysis of analysis, before making a decision. Hey, no one's gonna send me to wear a new school uniform that has itchy polyester 10 days before Labor Day, right? I don't like change, but I must admit that some things in life have worked out well for me, even when I could not, or especially when I could not evaluate all the options first. This is the virtue of obedience. This is what obedience service means. Obedience is not just about a sister of charity being sent from one convent to another because the provincial tells her to go there, or about the archbishop sending a priest to a new parish. These are examples, but all of us are called to obey the commandments, which guide and are guardrails for us in purity, integrity, honesty. It's not just about not stealing. It's also about finding all the ways in which we are called to be honest and people of integrity. And regarding obedience as a priest, on the night before my ordination, I sat down in front of the Archbishop of Newark. He opened an envelope, and it said I was coming to Our Lady of Lourdes. I didn't have time to run a background check on all you guys. It's worked out well. You have been a blessing to me. Even the seminary where I studied turned out to be a blessing for me in terms of both study and prayer. But I vacillated about going to the seminary for a while. When I was still in the trial, or let's try on this uniform phase, I was required to go for an interview with the rector and dean of Immaculate Conception Seminary at Seton Hall University. I had never met him, really didn't even know his name. But something about my 10-year-old self came roaring back when I met him. I don't like change. I was surprised to know his last name was Coleman, because at age 10, Coleman School was the school I was plucked out of. So suddenly, was I going back? The Emmaus Gospel reminds us that Jesus is back. Following him, we can find where we belong. In times of sadness, we are called to recognize our need for God, our need for love of neighbor, and to make that prayer both as individuals and as a community, to say, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over."
Our profession of faith, the Nicene Creed: I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our Savior destroyed death and restored life by rising again. Let us humbly ask him.
In the church, you created disciples to carry out your mission. Lead our children among their first communion in your love. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In the gift of the Holy Spirit, convert our individual talents and tasks into benefits for all, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who suffer with illness, for healing and strength, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our beloved deceased, Virginia Carlucci, John Mooney, Deacon Ernesto Abad, and Joan Papali, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intention of this Mass, for the eternal rest of the deceased members of the Pflug and Napolitano families, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, hear these prayers and those we keep in our hearts through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Please open your hymnals to number 445 and join in singing On the Journey to Emmaus.
Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant church, and as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and in his rising the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis our Pope and Joseph our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Our Lady of Lourdes, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you are pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you to our hardworking Tricky Tray leaders and team members who worked for many months to prepare for our Tricky Tray of last Saturday and the delivery of all the gifts last Sunday. To you, our young people, volunteers of all ages, thank you for being here. This year we also broadcast the Tricky Tray via our YouTube channel to almost 300 people who watched at home, and for the calling of the winning numbers. Our Tricky Tray team also endured a blackout, electrical power outage blackout due to a lightning strike across the street, telephone pole on fire, but we were not on fire. We just lost power for a couple of hours and we still got through it. Thank you to our hardworking volunteers. This coming week for young people, there is a confirmation class tomorrow evening, Monday, April 24th at 6:45 to 8 p.m. And then the very next evening, Tuesday, April 25th, there's a meeting here in church for the same young people with their parents. They're at two different times. So if you're not sure about the time of your meeting on Tuesday, please give us a call at the rectory, see me after Mass, or if you didn't get the email about this. Also after this Mass, there will be a Knights of Columbus pancake breakfast downstairs, $10 for adults, $5 for children. The Knights are raising money for their own charitable purpose, for charitable endeavors in the community. Thank you for your support. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth in peace. The Mass is ended.
Please open your hymnals to number 456 and join in singing now, The Green Blade Rises.